What would you do with all your money? Whether it's $5 or $5 million, what would you do with it? Some of us, we might run out and buy a foreign currency that we think would still have value. Maybe you'd go out and buy a bunch of cars because you like cars. Maybe you'd want to be able to barter. So you'd go buy cows and sheep and bees and so that you could trade things. Some of you might decide to take that money and while it has value, build a well in Uganda. What would you do if you knew that one day your money would have absolutely no value to you? Well, Jesus basically gives us an insider tip. And he tells us that one day we're not going to wake up. And one day we're going to stand in eternity and our money, our physical, tangible money, is no longer going to have value to us. So let's take a look at this parable in Luke chapter 16, often referred to as the parable of the shrewd dude. Luke chapter 16, verse 1. So as Jesus told his disciples, there was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So he called him in and asked him, "What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer." So we'll pause right there. So basically, this rich guy has a financial planner. And he's given the financial planner the ability to do whatever he wants with his money. And all of a sudden, he realizes the guy's wasting his money. And so he calls him in. He says, "Look, you have 2 weeks. The clock is ticking. Your time is up." And he's basically saying, "Wake up." And for us, again, knowing that one day we aren't going to wake up, the clock is ticking, that one day each and every one of us are going to end up in heaven, and God is basically going to do like this manager. He's going to take an audit of what we did with his resources while we're here on earth. So let's keep on reading here, verse 3. See what happens with this guy. It says, "The manager said to himself, 'What shall I do now? My master has taken away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg.'" Basically saying, "I'm white collar. I can't get a real job, and I can't beg." So, says, "I know what I'll do, so that when I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their houses." So he basically starts looking ahead, and he has this bit of an aha moment as he figures out, I have to start now planning for what's coming. I think all of us at different times in life, we have a variety of types of aha moments that lead us to plan for our future. I remember in middle school for me, I was actually one of the big kids. Can you imagine that? Yeah. And since middle school, I've grown like an inch. And in the last couple years, I've dropped another half an inch. All right. So, but between seventh and eighth grade, all of a sudden I came back for eighth grade. And that summer in between, my friend Banjo had grown 8 inches over the summer. And all of a sudden, I had this aha moment. And this aha moment was, I better start being nice to these guys now. Because here in a couple years, they're all going to be giants and I'm going to be this little dwarf. Right? And all of a sudden, I start planning for my future and how I make friends differently. Now, I found Christ shortly after that, so that was good help with that. But we have different types of aha moments in our lives. It might be with your health. Okay, I recently, just this last week, I had to go in and have my blood drawn, and they did my labs to see how I'm doing, and mine turned out great, thank you, Jesus. But I've had friends that went in, and they got a blood drawn, and they're in their 30s, and all of a sudden, they find out their cholesterol is all out of whack. And it's this aha moment that if they want their future health to be what they hope, then they have to start investing in that now. Another aha moment recently, my son, Peyton, who turns 10 tomorrow, and I was so proud of him because he'd been saving up some money between chores and different things he'd done. And he says, "Dad, I really want to go to college someday. And so can you help me and invest my money so that I'll have more money for college?" It's like, aha, he gets it. If he wants to have his ambitions come true, his long-term planning goals come true, then he has to start investing in that now. And this, for us, it's not that we look necessarily to our future, our retirement, and so forth, but this whole scenario, knowing that eternity is our destiny, we should be thinking our aha moments should lead us to plan for eternity and to look up to heaven. Moving on here in this parable, let's take a look at what he does here. As he begins, so he gets into action here, and he starts shaping up, or at least he starts planning for the future. Verse 5 says, "So he called in each one of his master's debtors. He asked the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' 900 gallons of olive oil, he replied. The manager told him, 'Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 450. Then he asked a second, and how much do you owe? 1,000 bushels of wheat, he replied. He told him, take your bill and make it 800. So he's trying to buy friends for later. He's saying, I'm going to scratch these guys' back now. I'm going to do them a big favor because real soon I'm going to have to turn around and ask them for some help. And what do you think happens? You think the manager is outraged, right? Actually, no. Let's read what happens with the manager. It says, the master commended the dishonest manager because he acted shrewdly. For the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than are the people of the light. It's like, wait a minute. Now, I think right there, that's why Jesus told this story. Kind of a shock factor. You would expect the master to be angry, but instead he commends him. But what he's commending him for is that finally the guy gets it. Finally, he gets that what he's doing now should be focused on his future. And he should be doing things to invest in his long-term future now. Now, unfortunately, he went and did it dishonestly, and I'm guessing he still lost his job. But he did commend him at this point. Let's read the rest of this passage and see what Jesus has to say about this. Jesus says, I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves, so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much, and whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. The Pharisees, who loved money, heard all this and were sneering at Jesus. He said to them, you are the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of others, but God knows your hearts. What people value highly is detestable in God's sight. So, several things that we can take away from this. And the first is that we need to invest our resources in a way that leads to friends who will greet us in heaven. Now, that it's not that we're doing what this, you know, shrewd dude was doing and trying to buy friends here and now. But rather, we invest so that we're going to see people in heaven because of what we've done with our resources now. Some examples of that. When I was a missionary out in Detroit in the late 90s, I worked for a pastor there, and day in and day out, we would have basketball tournaments in this gymnasium for gang kids. And it was absolutely awesome ministry. They couldn't wear their colors in. They would come in, they'd play hoops for hours, and they would always hear the gospel, usually at halftime. And we shared the gospel with so many gang kids out there because of that. Well, that gymnasium came into being because Mr. Brown, or my pastor's father, he owned this small franchise of donut restaurants in Florida. And this guy was really, really good at making money. And now, you know, Jesus isn't telling us here, stay away from worldly wealth. He's saying, use it strategically for the kingdom. And so Mr. Brown, what he did is he basically said, hey, I'm going to keep making money because that's what I'm good at. But I'm going to take that money and I'm going to put it where it pays eternal investment returns. And so he took that money and he paid for this $400,000 gymnasium for us to have these open gyms in the heart of Detroit, a rundown neighborhood. And so many kids are going to greet him one day in heaven because of that. That's using your resources to make friends that will meet you eternally. But maybe it's not financial resources that somebody invests. Maybe it's the pregnancy care center. I've heard so many stories of volunteers there where somebody comes in and they're distressed because of an unplanned pregnancy. And they come in and they sit down with a counselor there. And in the process, that person has the opportunity to share Christ with them. And so now, not only have they saved a life in this world, they've also saved a life for eternity. That's using your time, energy, your resources for eternal investments, eternal rewards to make sure that we have friends in heaven. A couple other verses on this that kind of drive this point that you can't take it with you, but you can send it ahead of you. 1 Timothy chapter 6, we taught on this a couple weeks ago, verses 17 and 19 through 19. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command those to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasures for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. And then in Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 and 20, it says, do not store up for yourselves treasure on earth, where moth and vermin destroy. I love that picture, by the way. You have moths and rats basically coming in and eating your money. But where moth and vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. You guys have all seen the people with that bumper sticker that says, he who dies with the most toys wins. Right? That's so wrong. He who dies with the most toys still dies. And has anybody here ever seen in a funeral procession as the hearse is pulling into the you know funeral that they have a U-Haul going behind them? Right? Once you go, you're gone and it stays behind. The idea is that the only safe and lasting treasure is the treasure that we store up in heaven. And that every gift given here on earth, every gift given in the name of Jesus is recorded and will be rewarded. Listen to Matthew chapter 10, verse 42. It says, and if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones, because he is my disciple, I tell you the truth, he will certainly not lose his reward. The point here is that God is keeping track of all of our acts of generosity that we do for Jesus. Okay, whether that is helping a little child, whether that's pulling over on the side of the road to help somebody in the rain whose tire has popped. Whether it's giving financially, whether it's volunteering somewhere, God is keeping track of all of these things, and one day he is going to reward us for that in heaven. Another concept from this whole passage, verses in 10 through 13, is the idea that kingdom investing leads to greater returns. Let's read verses 10 through 12 again. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling your worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? And the idea here of this being entrusted with these resources is really that God is saying money, material possessions, those are a test. He's testing us to see, can he trust us with something greater? These treasures in heaven, eternal rewards, can he trust us with that? And he's saying money now here on this earth is really the training wheels for your bicycle. And hopefully, as we learn to ride the bicycle and using those things for him, eventually we're losing the training wheels and we're hitting the BMX track. That's what he desires for us. In the way that we give, that all of our resources that God hands to us, that we would truly view them that way, as a manager mentality, not that they're our own for ourselves, but rather that everything we have is to basically say, God, how do I build up your kingdom more with this? Because this is all yours to begin with. That's the mentality he wants us to have. So let's talk a little bit more about some of these greater rewards. Kingdom investing, according to verses 10 and 11, leads to greater wealth. Now, that's not financial wealth, all right? The whole prosperity gospel, I think that's all a bunch of baloney, all right? That if you love Jesus, you're going to get rich. Not here, in eternity. But there are verse after verse that talks about, again, these building up treasures in heaven. And one treasure that I hope that I get one day when I get to heaven, it's mentioned in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 19, is I hope that someday I get the soul-winning crown. That when I get to heaven, that Jesus will literally hand me a crown and say, Dwayne, this is because you shared my gospel with people, and people are here because of you. Because you took that to them. Thank you, Butch. By the way, it's okay to say amen once in a while. Okay, this is the sort of treasure that I want to receive one day. Kingdom investing also leads to greater usability. Okay, and that's with our lives. If you think of the whole idea of the gospel, okay, let's read 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. It says, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. And the idea of greater usability, and it comes back to the core of the gospel, that each and every one of us have offended God by doing wrong. We call it sin. So we've offended God, and because of that, we have this eternal debt to pay. And this debt is one day eternal separation from God. And Jesus says, you know what? I got it covered. I'm going to step in, and I'm going to pay that debt for them. I'm going to die on the cross. I'm going to pay their debt so that I now own them. We oftentimes miss that. We talk about the free gift of God that Jesus gives us where we can have this relationship for eternity with God. And Jesus says, wait a minute. Yes, you can have eternity here, and that's a free gift. I'm giving it to you freely, but what I expect in return is all of you. And so God, he invests in us. He invests in our lives, and he wants our lives to be used for him. Everything that we do, not just our money, but our time, our energy, everything. He invests in us. He wants us to invest in his kingdom. Kingdom investing also leads to greater liberty. Greater liberty. Verse 13 says, no one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. You realize the best way to avoid greed and avoid coveting and the desire for stuff is to give it away. Every time you give something away, you are giving away your own lust for things. I love how John Wesley puts it in the Treasure Principle book. Now you guys, I hope you've been reading this, right? Been following along? By the way, if you haven't picked one up, there's some up here. You can come up and get them after the service. So, but page 70, John Wesley puts it this way. He says, money never stays with me. It would burn me if it did. I throw it out of my hands as soon as possible, lest it should find its way into my heart. That's a good way to avoid being mastered by money, is to get rid of it as quickly as possible. And so generosity, kingdom investing, leads to greater liberty. I want to take just a moment and show you this video that really kind of sums up as Jesus finishes, the Pharisees were sneering at him, and the world doesn't really get it. And so we have this video that I think depicts the difference between the way we should be investing and the way the world thinks we should be investing. Let's roll the video.
So, Mr. Gustafson, what can we here at Capital Financial Investment and Planning do for you today?
Well, I'm ready to start investing.
Great. I highly recommend it.
Specifically, I'm having a hard time nailing down exactly where I want to invest.
Mm-hmm. You're not alone in that, Mr. Gustafson. That's why there are professionals like myself to help you along. Our firm has one of the highest rates of return on the market today.
Cool. So what do you recommend?
Actually, I would like to hear some of your ideas before I offer suggestions. In the end, you are ultimately in control here. I'm here to help you develop a strategy based on your needs, but you make all final investment decisions. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think so.
Great. So, what are some areas in which you see yourself investing?
Well, there are a few, but the one that comes to mind is the boy who shovels my driveway.
The boy who shovels your driveway?
Yeah, great kid. But about a month ago, his dad just left. And it's been really hard on him and his mom.
I'm not sure I quite understand. Do you want to invest in snow shoveling? Or how exactly would you invest?
Maybe take him to a game or a movie or something like that. Maybe just spend some time with his family. See if there's a way I can help. You know, invest.
Okay, Mr. Gustafson, I'm not sure you completely understand
Wait, there's this guy at church. He's kind of new, but he really gets a lot out of it. But he's kind of on the fringe, you know? Like, I can tell he wants to connect with other people, but he's waiting on them to initiate. He's someone I absolutely want to invest in.
Mr. Gustafson, you do know what we do here, right?
Right. You help me find places to invest for my future.
Right. We help you choose investments, you know, property, businesses.
Oh, well, there's this one business.
Great.
It's a place that takes care of the homeless like a shelter. They offer all these other services like education and rehab. I've been thinking very seriously about volunteering there. That's a business?
Of sorts. It's a nonprofit organization. It's not going to offer you any returns.
What do you mean?
It wouldn't make you any money.
Money?
Yeah.
But I thought you said this was about the big picture.
Yes.
About my future, about maximizing returns. I mean, don't get me wrong. Money's great and all. But at some point, I'm gonna die. What about after that?
What do you mean after that?
I mean after I die. I can't take money with me. I need something that's gonna last forever.
The world does not always understand God's economy. And I think that you guys do, though. River Valley, here, this congregation specifically, is one of the most generous congregations I've ever been part of. And I actually want to just take a few minutes and share with you guys some of the things that you've done over this last year to invest in God's kingdom. And it's absolutely amazing. On the local level, let's see. You guys have been hearing us week after week talk about the Christmas baskets and, hey, everybody sponsor a Christmas basket. Well, this year, we're on track to hit over 100. We still need some more people to take those on. But last year, we gave out, from River Valley specifically, over 104 Christmas baskets to our community, to families in need. That's awesome. By the way, during this time in Butch, okay, it's okay to say amen or clap or whatever. So this is a good time to celebrate here. Other things, Strive. You guys remember the Strive banquet that we do every October for our, to help raise money to help with our youth program? In one night, you guys gave $11,700. That's amazing. Our firewood ministry that gives, you know, kind of takes wood to those in need, and especially this time of year who are trying to stay warm. The numbers, what they've told me is that they've served over 120 families so far this year. The car care ministry, okay, they do this, you know, every 3 months or so, or three times a year. Each time they serve over 100 cars of helping people. These are, you know, single moms, widows, military moms. Okay, these are people in our community that we are helping with these resources. It's amazing. One of my favorite, though, and I get to see it at work throughout the week, is the Lifeline ministry. Now, it's easy to get wrapped up in the numbers part of this because you guys know that first weekend, you're used to seeing these, right? The first weekend of every month, we drop these in these, and it's the love offering. And the love offering goes specifically for our Lifeline ministry. This year, you guys have given away over $38,000 already. That's amazing. But it's not about the money. It's really not about the money because in that, out of that, they've served over 1,500 people. Roughly half of those didn't receive money. But you know what? Every single one of them heard the gospel. And every single one of them have, I mean, you should come watch these guys and gals at work sometime. Every single one of them have had people speak truth into their lives, sometimes cold, hard truth. But really, the truth of how each and every one of us, our greatest need is the gospel. I love when I was at Multnomah in seminary, there's a gal there that published a book called Kitchen Table Counseling. And her whole philosophy is, she says, when people are in crisis, sometimes they have a tough time listening. And so her philosophy was, you meet the need, and then you introduce them to Jesus. And that's what our Lifeline ministry does, day in and day out. They meet the need, and they introduce people to Jesus. And you should come sometime and see the way they work, and see the way they help people in our body, in our community. We do that globally as well. Okay, this church, we send out, dependent on which way you choose to count, whether you count nationals or not in this count, we've sent out roughly anywhere between 15 and 30 missionaries that we have throughout the world that you guys are supporting, both as a body out of our budget and out of your own pocket helping people. That's amazing. This time of year, we always like to highlight our Uganda ministry as well. Okay, we're working on year 4 at this point. And orphans, okay, you guys, how many of you are sponsoring orphans? You know, okay. Did you know that we have over 600 orphans being sponsored out of here? Okay, the majority of those from River Valley. Just as a quick side on that, if you're interested in sponsoring an orphan, we had our facilitators picked out 33 ones that weren't sponsored that they really felt like there was a need for. So we have those 33 packets. There's only 16 of them left in the lobby. So if you're interested in sponsoring an orphan, go for that. Other things going on. Oh, you know, a real quick housekeeping issue on that. This is also the time of year, a lot of you, when in sponsoring your orphans, you've chosen to sponsor them annually. And so you just write one check for the entire year, and given that it's only $15 a month, that's not too hard to do for many of us. So, but if that's you, if this is the time that you usually write your annual check, please don't forget them. Support them for this next year, whether you need to write one check for the year or whether you want to drop to $15 a month or whatever. Anyway, I mean, just amazing stuff. But some of the things going on, they said, these orphans, okay, even though we only have 600 or so sponsored right now, there are well over 1,000 that hear the gospel through this ministry. Because a lot of the ministry that they do is to the community and open to all of the kids. And one of the cool things that God's done this last year for us, and really where he said, I want to entrust you, River Valley, with even more. You've been faithful with the orphans. I'm going to entrust you with something else. And he handed us ownership of a secondary school. So we now own a school in Uganda, and we just finally finalized the paperwork last month where we own the property, the school, the building, and all. And this school has over 400 students there. So now when you guys are sponsoring your orphan, and they, you know, you're helping them with their daily needs and their normal expenses, as they get through their primary school, so that's for us, elementary school, and they're ready to go on to secondary school, a lot of kids can't go. Well, we now have a school that we can send them to. And right now, there's 150 of those 400 kids at that school are boarded there. It's just absolutely amazing. Thank you. So, you know, I want to give you guys just a quick glimpse, you know, maybe a two-minute glimpse on this video of what's going on at the school. Do you guys see that picture of that kid studying with these lights? Okay, between you guys and the company that owns these, we've sent over 200 of these over to those kids so that they can read, so that they can do their homework, they can read the scriptures. You meet the need and you invite them to Jesus. Every one of the kids at that school are being taught Bible so that not only are they having their basic needs met, they're learning the gospel that then they can take home to their own family and to their community. That's kingdom investing. That's investing resources now that have an eternal return. That's what Jesus calls us to do. If you were to go in and talk to a financial planner, there's three questions that they'll ask you in one way or another. They always come up. The first is, what are you planning for? Are you saving up for a car? Are you saving up for college, for a house, retirement? What are you planning for? And for us, hopefully, as we are planning on those, you know, things that make sense in this life as well, but hopefully our main focus of what we're planning for is eternity. And then what do you have to invest? That's the next question. Is it that you have $5 to invest a month or $5 million to invest somewhere? What do you have to invest? For some of us, we may have less financially to invest than others, but there are all kinds of ways that we can still invest. Maybe investing for you looks like inviting someone to your home group, knowing that you're going to need to put some time and attention into that relationship. Maybe investing for you is putting your own comfort level on at risk as you invite someone to one of the Christmas services in a couple weeks. Maybe your investment is in children's ministry, working with, because there's a great need right now to work with our kids here, not just global, but here. All kinds of ways that we can be investing. So what do you have to invest? And then what kind of a return do you want? Do you want something that only provides an earthly return? Or do you want to invest your resources in a way that not only have earthly returns, but also have eternal rewards as your return? In the Treasure Principle, page 80, I love how it's summed up here. Randy Alcorn says, unbelievers have no second chance to relive their lives, this time choosing Christ. That's a cold, hard truth. We have this life and this life alone to choose Jesus. And if you haven't done that, please talk to one of us today, whether it's our prayer team or somebody sitting next to you, talk to somebody about how you begin a relationship with Jesus. Then he goes on, he says, but Christians also get no second chance to live life over, this time doing more to help the needy and invest in God's kingdom. We get this life and this life alone to invest in all of eternity and to invest in other people. Last night after preaching, I went home and my wife was flipping through the stations. And you guys remember the movie, it's an oldie. It says, It's a Wonderful Life. And there was this one scene, we only watched it for like 5 minutes. One scene popped up and in a picture on a wall, it said this. It says, all that you can take with you is that which you've given away. All you can take with you is that which you've given away. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for entrusting so much to us, and especially to us here as Americans, where you've blessed us with so much, so abundantly. God, let us be faithful stewards. Let us keep you in mind in your kingdom so that all that we are, all that we do, all that we have gets invested in your kingdom. God, show each and every one of us what that means for you and how we can love on you more that way. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.